to start. Sudden death overtime. North Stars won an overtime game here in 85. Dennis Marook scored the winning goal. In a year that the North Stars eliminated the Blackhawks. So overtime is underway. Ulf Dahlin has the puck for Minnesota. Steve Thomas for the Blackhawks starts out. Jeremy Roenick with Thomas and Larmer moving in over the blue line. They're turned back. Bobby Smith to Mark Tenorti. Those two have played a lot for Minnesota tonight. Dave Manson for Chicago as the North Stars make a change. Larmer coughed up the puck at center ice to Mike Modano. Now he gets it back, dumps it just inside the blue line, and here's Brian Glynn, number 6 for Minnesota. Dumps the puck in, and the North Stars give chase. Modano, centering pass in front, the puck hops over Brian Propp's stick. Chambers sends the puck in off the glass. Manson to Larmer. Johnson brings the puck around to the boards and by a few Blackhawks heading to the bench on a line change. And Belfour comes out, decides not to play, and left the puck to Keith Brown. We welcome viewers of Sports Channel America. You're with TSN, the sports network. And overtime at Chicago Stadium.
Chicago have not been forechecking like I assumed that they would do. They, in fact, have been just sending one man in this overtime. They're building. I would have thought different.
2 minutes into this overtime period. Adam Creighton, number 22 for the Hawks. In over the blue line, dumps it into Dirk Graham's corner. Casey's out to play the puck. Mike Craig. Can't get it by Doug Wilson, who keeps the puck in behind the net. Presley reaching for it. Gets the puck. Tried to feed McGill at the point, and he gave the puck away. Here's a 3-on-2 for the Stars. Duchesne can't get a shot away in front. Mike Craig tipped the puck, but he was checked by Doug Wilson of the Blackhawks. Send the puck down the ice. Chris Dahlquist is back. Icing call against Chicago.
So without Roenick and Larmer on the ice, then I think Mike Keenan has told his other lines that they better go to one man in forechecking unless they are certain that they've got possession of the puck before they send that second or third man in. But again, it may have a lot to do with Mike Keenan analyzing the situation after three periods and knowing full well that the North Stars have taken advantage of them on their goals by catching the Blackhawks in too deep forechecking.
That looks a little odd, doesn't it? 22, 20, and 2 in overtime. Oh, a long time ago, very early in the National Hockey League, they played 2-game total goal series, and there would be curfews and games that would be called. So there were a couple of teams that went into overtime and tied, and they'd go to the next game of the total goal series. Curfew tonight. They'll play all night if they have to decide this one. Bobby Smith centering pass. Dahlquist trying to keep the puck in and can't. It's drifted away from him. Now he backhands the puck in. Dahlin left the puck because there was a delayed offside. Now here's Ulf Dahlin with Bellows and Smith. Centering pass. Smith reaches for it. Cleared by Mike Hudson to center. Chambers dumps the puck back in for Minnesota. And now the whistle goes and Terry Gregson stops the play because Gillis and Dahlin were at each other in front of the Minnesota bench. And mostly Gillis after Dahlin.
Gregson sending both of the players. Mike Keenan sure using his whole bench in this overtime, but I think probably trying to play a hunch. Looking for someone unexpectedly who could score.
Keenan has used primarily three lines for most of the night. Paul Gillis has seen limited action, so has Jocelyn Lemieux. Cudson has been spotted on a few lines, so he's seen a little more action. So three lines plus one for much of the night. And Bob Gainey has used all of his bench. Although in the latter stages of the game, Chirla, Bureau, and Basil McRae have probably played less than the other forwards.
And I'd like to have had a clock on the skates of Bobby Smith tonight.
Long shot in on Ed Belfour by Brian Glynn. Chambers. The center, Gagne, was onside but couldn't come up with a puck.
Gagne just got Keith Brown's stick right in his face as Brown wheeled it back. Gagne caught it. It was just the way that Keith Brown was skating.
Ooh. Remember in the playoffs here last year, in one game, both Keith Brown and Denny Savard were ejected from the game for high-sticking major. Last year, they had to call the major and throw the player out of the game. And in a game that the Blackhawks won, both Brown and Savard were thrown out. And it appears there'll be a penalty to Keith Brown here, so we'll zip out to Calgary. Here's Jim.
Calgary Flames in the third period thought they had caught the Edmonton Oilers. This is the nasty net that did not allow a goal by Joe Nieuwendyk. He is right in on Grant Fuhr and has him obviously beat, but as the net puck goes into the corner, it hits the meshing, does not completely go over the line. The puck stays there, no goal. Subsequently, the Oilers come back at the other end of the ice. Marc Messier around the net tries to jam it. The rebound goes to Glenn Anderson. He puts it above a prone Mike Vernon, and it's now 3-1 with about 4 minutes to play at the Saddle Dome in Calgary.
And a little bit of controversy here because Terry Gregson has called 2+2, double minor for high sticking on Keith Brown. Last year he would have had no choice but to throw him out of the game. It would have been a major in a misconduct, but now it's 2+2. And the Minnesota North Stars go to the power play. They're 2-for-11, and some of the fans here start to litter the ice with debris.
Might almost mean the same thing tonight. Keith Brown might not see any more action. The North Stars with the power play for the next 4 minutes could just be all that it takes.
It's just been penalty after penalty tonight for the Blackhawks. They've given the Minnesota North Stars every opportunity to win the game on the power play. And now they get a 4 minute power play in overtime. And it'll take a little while to get this going because the ice is littered with debris.
But I can remember Mike Keenan a year ago preaching to his players after game number one the same thing, is that they had to control their bad penalties. They had to have discipline.
The most penalized team in the league through the regular season counted on sensational penalty killing to counteract that. Wonder if it'll catch up to them on the first night of their playoffs. Two power play goals for Minnesota. Mark Tenorti and Neil Broughton scored with a man advantage in the first period. Since then, they've had 9 more chances and haven't scored.
The fans in this building for years have been maybe the loudest fans, well, no question about that, in the NHL, but also for years they have shown no regard for the players on the ice by continually pelting the players in the ice with debris, as they have just done now.
Now we clean up here. Let's bounce up, let's just go to Los Angeles.
You say so, Jimmy. Third period action, LA and Vancouver. Luke Robitaille coming in on Troy Gamble with a defender all over him. He gets spun around and still manages to put the puck behind Gamble, and there was some debate as to whether this goal should be allowed, but he was carried into the crease, and the Kings are starting to open up things on the Canucks. They now lead 5-3. That's in the second period.
Did he say 5-2?
3.
5-3.
Second period. And here it's 3-3. We're bouncing back to Pittsburgh tomorrow night. Game number two in the Patrick Division semifinal between the Pittsburgh Penguins and the New Jersey Devils. It's a 7:30 Eastern start. How will the Penguins do on night number two of the playoffs? They look very nervous as the favorites in the game. They were outplayed by the New Jersey Devils. And the pressure's really on them to win tomorrow night. Same could be said of Mike Keenan's team if they don't survive this double minor penalty to Keith Brown here in overtime.
You think Mike Keenan's staring at John Casey? Uh-uh. He's focusing on one person again, as he's done a number of times in tonight's game, and that one person is referee Terry Gregson. Doesn't bother Gregson the least bit. Keenan can stare all he wants. He's called it like a tight game tonight.
Smith, Kropp, and Bellows up front of the power play. Tenorti and Broughton, the defenseman. Manson and Chelios, Dirk Graham and Steve Larmer out to kill the penalty. They had to do a lot of that tonight. Kropp to Tenorti. Tried to carry the puck in, ran into Graham, and the play's offside.
And more words of intimidation are exchanged as they have since the puck was dropped in tonight's game. Larmer and Broughton having words as they went shoulder to shoulder.
Late change now by Mike Keenan. He'll get Jeremy Roenick on the ice. And Troy Murray. Can you really do much intimidating in the playoffs, or is it pretty much all set up by this time? They've seen each other 8 times through the regular season. They played in the playoffs last year.
That's why I think so, that there is so much intimidation when you've seen each other that much during the course of the season and the great rivalry. Yeah, they're sick of each other by the time you get to playoffs.
Neil Pratt to Bobby Smith and back to Pratt. Over to Tenorti. To the net. They score! Brian Kropp has won the game for the Minnesota North Stars in overtime on the power play. 4-3 Stars. First of the playoffs. And the North Stars have won it.
Tenorti, who's had a strong game, just threw that puck right on net. Brian Kropp was standing right to the left of Belfour. Let's watch it from Belfour's angle. Just as he went to make the save, he did get a piece of it. But he was down and out. And Kropp, who has quick hands, was at the right place at the right time.
Tenorti and Broughton assist on Kropp's goal that wins it for the Minnesota North Stars. And the fans show their displeasure with Terry Gregson as he leaves the ice, and good thing he's gone. So many upsets around the National Hockey League playoffs on night number one of the conference division semifinals. And tonight in Chicago, it's the North Stars who've upset the Hawks 4-3.
No scoring the winning goal.
Jeff Cordell scoring the winning goal in overtime against the Jets.
Podelski leaves it back of the goal for Robinson. Doesn't appear as though the Canucks are going to change their strategy at all. They're going to try and force the Kings in deep in their own zone. Podelski unable to get around Dirk. Casper following up in the play. Runs into Ronning. The puck comes loose. Cardinals pass intended for Linden, too far. It slides all the way down the ice. Fired out of the zone quickly by the Kings. Dirk shoots it in. Back after it goes to Shane. He leaves it there along the board. Linden got it back to the point to Lume. And his quick shot up high on Kelly Rudy. He makes the save with 19-12 remaining in overtime.
Pat Quinn, having to start the line first, started his best offensive line, trying to get his team with a little momentum here at the start of overtime. And the Kings had to counter with the defensive line. I think it really helps when your general manager is your coach, Pat Quinn, giving some instructions. And I think Pat Quinn feels a lot more comfortable now that he's behind the bench. He knows what the players are like. He's been there before. Real hands-on position when you're the coach and GM.
Mariano against John Tinelli in the face-off circle. Puck came back into the corner. Now Tinelli along the boards is trying to pry it loose along with Tim Waters. They continue fighting for it deep in Los Angeles territory. We played just over a minute of this first overtime period. Vancouver leading this series 1-0 after their 6-5 victory on Thursday night. Marty McSorley slides it into the corner. Back after it goes Gerald Dittick. Sandstrom now comes out onto the ice, replacing Tinelli. The Kings' number one line is out there. Granato for Sandstrom. Sandstrom has to circle in the center ice area. Ahead for Gretzky. Gretzky back to Sandstrom. A shot that goes off a skate. Back of the lot of Vancouver goal. Adams along the board. Puts it out of the zone. The Kings gain control. Granato ahead to Gretzky. Gretzky to Granato. Granato to Gretzky. And it was too far for him.
Thomas Sandstrom was wide open as Gerald Dittick had fallen down, and Sandstrom throws the pass to Gretzky.
Capuano has his attempted pass blocked. It goes all the way down the ice. Robitaille trying to keep it in the zone. Nedved picks it up. Anesso trying to bring it out. Loses it to Alec. Alec goes into the corner along with Kerber, looking for Robitaille. It bounced away from him. And Manesso flips it to the line, but not out. Manesso will get another opportunity. Again, this time they do clear the zone as it was knocked back in offside by Todd Ellick.
Canucks a little careless, tried that diagonal pass out of their own zone, didn't get it up high enough, and Steve Duchesne knocked it down. It's almost like the teams when Gretzky's line comes on, they play a total defensive game, and the same thing with the LA Kings when Ronning's line comes on. Both goaltenders have been very sharp tonight. The Canucks have had 3 goalposts behind Kelly Rudy. But he's made the big save when he's had to. Steve Bolzek shorthanded, had a breakaway, and Rudy made the save. And in the last 10 minutes of the third period, Troy Gamble was just outstanding.
Gamble again playing like he did at the start of the season when he was the hottest goaltender in the National League for the first 6 weeks of the season. Kerber's off the boards to Nedved. Dumped in, and Duchesne is back there after it. Duchesne gets away from Nedved, but Mervin picks off the pass. He fires it back into Los Angeles territory. Harry Robinson chased behind his net. Up along the board for Taylor. Taylor with some help from Ellick, trying to get out. Stolen by Mimesso. Over to Capuano. Capuano looking back to the point for Mervin. A long shot deflected by Mimesso. And Rudy had to react quickly on that one.
Some good pressure again by the Vancouver Canucks, forechecking the LA defenseman.
An icing call, and now Mimesso and Taylor get involved in the neutral zone with 16:40 remaining in this first overtime period.
And Marty McSorley and Larry Robinson have been paired back together again on the LA defense.
And both Taylor and Mimesso are going to go off to the penalty box.
Tom Webster talking about Steve Duchesne playing his best hockey with Larry Robinson. Marty McSorley played his best this year, paired with Larry Robinson for most of the year. And you look at some of the players that Larry Robinson has played with, they're all playing better with him.
The Vancouver Canucks have never lost a playoff game in Los Angeles. All one-goal decisions. If they win again tonight, it will be another one-goal decision. They won both games here in Los Angeles in 1982, the year they went to the Stanley Cup Final before losing 4 straight to the New York Islanders.
They played well enough to win tonight, especially in the first 2 periods.
You know, in the Kings' best 2 seasons, they also lost in the first round of the playoffs, 74-75, and they had 105 points. They lost to Toronto. And in 80-81, when they had 99 points, they lost to the New York Rangers. Linden trying to throw it out front for Cortnell. Ronning has it now. Ronning tried to get it back to Linden. It goes behind the net. Rudy played it up along the boards, and finally it's knocked out to center ice. Kadelphy rink wide to Casper. Casper looking for someone to pass it to. He's being bothered there by Dirk, and it's picked off by the Canucks. Linden starts back. Long shot. That went off the stick harmlessly to the corner. McSorley back of the net, plays it off the boards and down the ice as Dirk is unable to keep it in at the point.
And you can see the Canucks with this line, the players hang high, they're waiting for that long pass and try to create some offensive chances.
An offside call as it was touched by Sandstrom with Gretzky inside the blue line.
Trevor Linden was it just in behind Gretzky, and Linden had Cliff Ronning in behind the LA defense. Difference in the offensive output, and you'd wonder how this series could be so close with the Canucks having the edge. And you look at the Kings' offensive output, but come playoff time, it seems that the team defense seems to win.
The only team in the NHL this year with 340 goal scorers, Robitaille, Sandstrom, and Gretzky. Granato trying to keep it in against Mazur. Bounces over to Lume. Lume to his defensive partner Didek, who hammers it off the board. Blake takes a hit from Larionov in the neutral zone. The puck comes loose to Lume. Lume coming in. Long shot fired just wide. At the point, Didek takes a shot that bounces to the goal mouth, kicked away by Rudy. Slipped down the ice for Gretzky. Gretzky tried to slide it across to Sandstrom, who was racing up on the play, and it was intercepted by Lume. Pass intended for Larionov, too far, picked up by Lume. Lume working from the corner. Tries to throw it out front. Rudy flips that one to the boards, and it's dumped out by Sandstrom.
Connects with another two-on-one, but Wayne Gretzky did a good job coming back and forcing Jyrki Lume to shoot that puck from long range.
John Tinelli at center ice, spun around. Gets the puck back again, comes in across the line. John Tinelli gives it to Alec. Alec throws it up front, and it deflected off Kerber's. It almost went in. It hit the post. Shot from Duchesne goes wide. Gamble really had to move quickly on that one as that puck deflected off Kerber's and went off the post.
Great reaction by Troy Gamble just to get a piece of that one.
Merzen fires it out of the zone. 14-13 remaining in overtime. Here's Tinelli moving in. He jams it. The net is off its support. The light is on, but they're ruling no goal. Mark Fawcett was there immediately. He ruled no goal.
Tinelli crashing towards the net. Troy Gamble made the original save. And Tinelli tried to jam it in. Mark Fawcett immediately waved the goal off. There was no hesitation whatsoever. Here's another look at it. Now you be the judge. Here's the play, and the fans are describing their displeasure. Here's Tinelli, goes to the backhand. Now look at the save. Gamble makes the save. He's got it under his leg. Ooh, that's a pretty close one. Whether it's over the line or not, before the goal comes off. Here's a better angle. Now watch the play. Tinelli tries to jam it in. Gamble's got his legs tight against the post, makes the save. But right there, where the puck is across the line before the net is off, hard to tell.
Mark Fawcett wasted little time. He was there, and you'll watch him on the right-hand side of the screen. He waves it off immediately.
Even with the video replay, that would be a hard one to call. Mark Fawcett, no hesitation whatsoever, waved it off.
14:04 remaining in overtime. 2-2 the score. Vancouver leading this Vice Division semifinal 1-0 as a result of a 6-5 win on Thursday night. Ronning at center ice.
Long shot, gloved by Rudy. He leaves it at the side of the net for Robinson. Cortnell's on him quickly. Robinson trying to get away, and he does bring it out to center ice. Stopped at the line, the puck loose in the skates of Dirk, who moves it ahead to Cortnell. Cortnell falls, tried to throw it out front. Linden and Cortnell are both there. Cortnell comes up with it. Cortnell taken in against the boards by Casper. Loose puck dug out by Linden to Ronning. Ronning circles in the corner to get away from Robinson. Ronning trying to throw it out front. Still has it. Does flip it out front, but nobody was in position, and it slides back into the Vancouver zone.
There's four Kings in the slot area covering up. No black sweaters for Ronning to throw the puck to.
Steve Duchesne in his own zone. To Robinson. Robinson, a rink-wide pass for Sandstrom. And it's a two-line pass resulting in a whistle with 12:58 remaining in overtime.
Thomas Sandstrom jumped off the bench and was offside on that play. If I was going to pick one of the LA Kings who was going to score the overtime winner, I'd pick Thomas Sandstrom, mainly because he is out there with Wayne Gretzky, and Gretzky doesn't have a point tonight.
Well, Wayne Gretzky has been very complimentary this season about his two line mates, Thomas Sandstrom and Tony Granato. This unit has really clicked for the Los Angeles Kings.
The only time the Kings struggled all year long was in their second 20 games of the season, and that coincided with the injuries to Sandstrom and Granato.
Gretzky comes in against Lune. Gretzky behind his back for Marty McSorley. Long shot. It's offside. I believe Sandstrom was in across the line ahead of the play.
And the LA Kings didn't like that call either. Marty McSorley jumping up into the play a little more. Got burned in game one when he jumped up into the play with a score 5-4. Has really played a more disciplined game this year. Not taking very many stupid penalties. Kept his plus minus right up there all year long, and everybody was waiting for McSorley to have a bad month, and he just never did.
Benning shoots it in off the glass. Lume unable to get it out. Blake fired it high and wide. In back of the net, Gretzky can't pick it up. Blake pinches in from the point. Sandstrom has it. Gets it to Gretzky. Gretzky out front. Backhand shot saved by Gamble. Blake at the point. Couldn't keep it in. Now does fire it into the Vancouver zone. The Kings trapped inside the line. Have to come back to touch up.
Another big save by Troy Gamble.
Granato takes it away from Larionov. It comes across to McSorley. McSorley in across the line. Let's the shot go. Gamble the save. And now the Canucks start away. Jay Mazur with a long shot off a leg. Picked up by Marty McSorley. 11:36 remaining in this first overtime. 2-2 the score. Capuano having problems against Robitaille. Picked up by Mimesso. It's offside.
The Kings want that faceoff deep in the Canucks zone, but Mimesso is only about half a step inside the blue line. Mimesso not only gives the Canucks a little more offense, he's big and he's strong, and that's what they needed, was some size up front. And with the trade for Dan Quinn, who wasn't fitting in very well with the Vancouver Canucks, they got some size.
Mimesso, two assists in game one and an assist on the first goal tonight. So he has 3 points in playoff activity.
Canucks tried to get Dan Quinn going early this year. They gave him a alternate captaincy and then made him one of the tri-captains, but it just didn't seem to work in Vancouver for Dan Quinn.
Mimesso keeps it in. There's the shot, and Rudy has to make a save going down on that quick release by Sergio Mimesso.
Mimesso was hoping that Rudy'd be screened, but by the time Mimesso let the shot go, Kelly Rudy was in good position and saw it all the way. Right from the faceoff. Now watch the Kings get confused here with the linesman in the way. They get in the bad defensive position. It bounces over McSorley's skate and stick. Watch a quick shot by Mimesso. But Rudy at the last second picks it up. makes the save and hangs on.
Kelly Rudy, since mid-February, a record of 12-1-1, 2.32 goals against average during that time, and he had three shutouts in his last seven starts during regular season play.
Played fairly well in the Kings game in game one. No bad goals, but he didn't make as many big saves as he did for the LA Kings down the stretch.
Pat Quinn showing a lot of confidence in the rookie, Peter Nedved. He's taken a regular shift in both these games. Robitaille. And across the line, still controlling it, gives it to Taylor. His shot, a high blast, goes wide. At the point, Robinson fires it wide. Moves ahead to Nedved. He was looking for Capuano. The play broken up by Robinson.
Another 3-on-2 for the Vancouver Canucks as this line with Alec Robitaille and Taylor got caught in behind the net.
Fired down the ice. Icing is waved off. Robinson banks it up along the board. Kept in. Now it's knocked out to center ice. Fired right back in by Robert Dirk. 10:32 remaining in this first overtime period. 2-2, Vancouver and Los Angeles. Vancouver winning the first game, 6-5. Lead pass on the left side. Here's an opportunity for Alec, and it's fired wide. Another shot that Gamble gets a piece of. Canucks having some problems getting it out of their own zone. Lidster finally flips it out. Marty McSorley gains possession. He dumps it ahead. Pass on the right side for Kadelski. He's checked by Robert Dirk. McSorley shoots it back in. 9:50 remaining in overtime.
Wayne Gretzky double shifting out there now with Steve Kasler and Mike Donnelly.
Donnelly broke up the play, but it's knocked ahead to Cortnell. Then he's checked by Gretzky. Linden in across the line with Cortnell. Cortnell is checked. Lume has it at his own line. Lume gets away from Donnelly in across the line to Ronning. Ronning takes the shot. Cortnell was cruising in front, and he was covered there by McSorley. Gretzky now moves it ahead to Sandstrom. He fires it just wide, trying to pick the far corner.
Cortnell. Another good quick shot by Thomas Sandstrom that just missed the far side. I think he surprised Troy Gamble with that one.
There he comes again. Sandstrom with the shot. The rebound. Gretzky shoots. He scores!
Congratulated by his teammates, but you think of overtime, you think of the clutch players. Gretzky held pointless for the first three periods. Going to overtime, you know that he's going to pick it up a notch, and you wonder whether everybody else on the ice can. Gretzky is one of those players who can reach down and get that little extra. There, him and Sandstrom driving to the net. Sandstrom had a good chance before that, along with Tony Granato. And look at the number of saves Gamble makes. Here's the first save and the shot by Sandstrom is tipped. He can't control the rebound. Another save on Granato. And here it is, Wayne Gretzky on the third rebound, up and over Troy Gamble. Now watch Gamble, one save. Stays on his feet. The rebound by Granato, he's got to go down to get that one, and he can't recover quickly enough to get the third shot by Wayne Gretzky.
And Gretzky waited before putting it up high, and when he scored, this is what happened at the Los Angeles bench. And I'm sure a tremendous load of pressure is off the shoulders of the team that finished first in the Spice Division with the overtime winner by Wayne Gretzky.
The country was saying we could rule out those six players.
Yeah.
We'll see. These teams played one game last year that went into overtime in their six-game first round, and it was the third game of the series here in Montreal. Brian Scudlin's goal won it for the Canadiens by a score of 2-1.
A penalty in the third period. Cote at 14:57 proved to be the turning point for Buffalo as far as getting this far concerned. Well, Cote was off. He had but 2 seconds left in the penalty when Andrejak got the game's only power play goal.
And that was the only power play chance for either team in the third period.
Well, you know, in the old days, it used to almost be impossible to get the referee to call a penalty. But in the last couple or 3 years, referees will call a flagrant penalty in OT. And their instructions by their supervisors are, if it's one that looks like it's A guy was trying to hurt somebody, you have to call it. And B, if it takes a good scoring opportunity away from the player, you have to call it. Let's hope that doesn't happen.
Overtime is underway. Game five. The series tied, 2 games apiece. So this is the big turnaround game tonight. Four of the team goes to Buffalo. Here's Keen coming in. He's tied up in time. And the Sabres quickly get out, led by Tandy and Rutu. Tandy comes in with a shot. That missed on the short side. Gilchrist Kearney got rid of the puck. Andrejak shoots it back in. Cote coming out for Canadiens. Keen didn't get the pass. Now he doesn't see it. Savard does. Can't move it though. Savard again turning around. David Keane a little too far. Haller watching Keane, who has two of the Canadiens' 3 goals tonight. Sabres, Ledyard out with Andrejak. Andrejak, who got us to overtime, got as far as the blue line. Had it knocked off his stick. Powerchuk played it ahead. Too high. Again over the glass. And in among the spectators. They play 51 seconds in overtime.
Bow will have a Molson 3-star selection for you whenever this game ends. Quickly or long time before it's all over. Harry, what about the mindset here? Home team, visiting team, what's the story in overtime in the playoffs, or is it really up for grabs?
I think both teams are probably saying, defensemen, let's let the forwards get the winning goal, so don't get caught or pinched on a gamble. And the forwards are saying, you defensemen, you get it out of our own end and we'll end this game.
And get it out is what Howardchuk did. He slapped to the length of the ice. He's playing.
Chase back there, here's Shannon intercepting. Shannon centered it.
Blade of the skate and stayed there and wouldn't come out on a real good point shot by Juve Krupp.
Patrick made that stop. Here's the turnover right here. Now watch where the puck goes after the stop by Patrick Waugh. Watch this now. Under the back of the skate. It doesn't stay there. He kicks it in.
Right.
It was right into the wide open net. Better look at it here. Lower level camera. The save is made, but barely after the giveaway by defenseman Dufresne.
Shane Corson nearly put it in.
Here's Kudlin against Powerchuk. Big face-off to the right of Patrick Waugh. Sabres four of them along the line. Here's Ramsey's shot. Draw the save. Covering on the short side and Riche. Flipped it ahead, but it's not out. Sabres starting to press the Canadiens here in overtime. They played a minute and a half. This one lifted all the way down the ice. Kudlin won't get near it. Ramsey will, and that's icing again against the Canadiens, so it'll come all the way back.
Well, through the first 1:32 of overtime, Pat Burns' team has been backed up by Rick Dudley's team. And it's been all Buffalo.
Well, Dudley's team's had two decent opportunities, and the ice is hardly cut up at all in the end that Pat Burns wants to see the puck.
Lining up to the left of the Montreal net, Bergeron, Ray, McGilvey, Bodger, and Tim Sutton. From the faceoff, the Canadiens don't move on it. Ray got in front. Taken in on the boards by Cordino. Schneider and Cote are the Montreal defensemen. Ray is going back to the net, but Cordino has the puck. Cardinal looking for room to skate out. Can't find it. So he dumps it to center right. Sutton back in with it. Carboneau stopping. Got a pass ahead to McPhee. With Cardinal. McPhee coming up. He gets over the line. McPhee put on strike and a backhander away. Malarchuk grabbed that and he has to drop it. And out come the Sabres, led by McGillney. His shot hit Schneider and then Cote. Ahead to Cardinal. Got rid of it again. Sabres are on it. Shot back in by Sutton. Long coverage. Schneider played it ahead along the boards and Cardinal hammered it out to center right. 2.5 minutes into overtime. Schneider misses it. Route 2 reaching for it. So is Candy. Carboneau coming up with Cardinal. Cardinal to the line. Couldn't move it. Three Sabres turn and come back. Puck is off Cote. Route 2 fell. Cote takes it in around the net. Gets out with it. A nice play to LeBeau. LeBeau, the team. Back to LeBeau. LeBeau shoots. Nice save by Malarchuk. Sabres the other way here in overtime. On the right side is Ledger up on the play. Tried to go in. Canadians break it up. They get it out over the line, and Andrechuk is turning to come back in for Buffalo. Shot in. Waugh stopped it behind the net. LePage. Nearing the 4-minute mark of overtime, LePage. Up to the line. Canadians just get it out. High stick making contact, and they stop it again.
Fred Malarchuk stopped LeBeau. Wasn't so much that stop, I felt, as the rebound came right out. And a couple of the Canadians, Keane in particular, skated right by it without a chance to make a play. Here comes LeBeau, Harry on the right side.
It is a nice stop. But you're right, it's a fast rebound, and it goes by two Canadians. It was in the air when it went by him. Here's another look at it. It goes by one, two, and Buffalo are gone on a 3-on-2. LeBeau hasn't played much. He's the kind of a guy that could end the game like this. His legs have got to be fresh.
Kenny, the other night in Buffalo, that would have deflected in.
Richie put it up as far as the Buffalo line. Group shoots it down the ice. This will be icing. LeBeau is back to touch it, and a faceoff coming up for the first time here in overtime inside the Buffalo line.
Well, I'll tell you this, one of the areas that Buffalo has had real trouble in is winning the draw. And in overtime, as a coach, it really is a shuddering thought to think that the other team's going to start with the puck, especially in your zone, more often than you are. The loss of a draw would mean the loss of a game. Let's see if Buffalo can improve that part of their game here in OT.
Canadians are changing again, and Pepper wants Carboneau on with Cardinal and McPhee. Desjardins and LePage are the defensemen. Pergeon will take the faceoff for Buffalo. Gilney and Snuggerud with him. Ramsey and Proof. And Randy Minton doesn't drop it in. He skates inside the circle. He moves them back. Now drops it in. From the draw, the Sabres get out. Three of them. Snuggerud to McGillney. McGillney trying to get around the save. He can't do it. It's rifle off the board. Ramsey shot. That is blocked. Ramsey again. Trying to push it in front of the net, but Desjardins, the defenseman, blocked his shot. And he held on to it.
You see Geek Carboneau blocked that shot. That hit him in the face area, or I don't know where. He just went down. It seemed to hit him the upper body, but Buffalo didn't lose that faceoff, Harry, and they bumped out of their own zone very quickly.
Well, it went back against to the Montreal side, but watch Carboneau gets down too early and slides further than he thought, sooner than he thought, and ducks, or he'd have taken that right in the face. You can see there he turns, takes it on the helmet. Dangerous thing, Blockenstein.
Faceoff to the right of the walk. Up to 4 minutes of overtime here at the Forum. Fifth game, series tied, 2-2. Desjardins rushing. Put a backhand pass in front of the net. Here's Mike McPhee back to the goal. Can't dump it out front. Sutton clearing it. McGillney is racing in there with Snuggerud. Here's McGillney. He left it there with upended down the Canadiens. Get the puck out. But the play is called. And Randy Mitten, the linesman, goes all the way down. I think that had to be on an offside call. so it'll be outside the Montreal blue line.
Now, this one's still going on in Montreal. It's all over in Boston, the Bruins, with 6 goals in the third period. They beat the Hartford Whalers 6-1. The Devils upset the Penguins in Pittsburgh 4-2. That's the final score. And at Madison Square Garden, New York, overtime as well. The Rangers and the Washington Capitals tied 4-4.
And as you see, they're going to do an inside the Canadian blue line.
Vanderchuk is by far the best faceoff man for the Buffalo Sabres. Rucci moves over to play the wing, and Vanderchuk takes the draw.
Drudelin for Montreal. Drudelin won it, but at the line, Krug shot. It was deflected and went wide of the net. Ross saw it all the way. Schneider can't get up. He's stopped by Tanny. Drudelin has to go back against Rucci. Thorsen on the other side. He's double-teamed. Schneider bumped his man on the boards behind the net. It is reshaped for Montreal, slapping it. It got off Ramsey's glove out to center. Sabres shoot it back in, Waugh down, taking no chances. Here's Richie. Pass goes up over center. Krulin shoots it in. Vanderchuk stopped it behind the net. Thorsen was in a hurry. Vanderchuk for Buffalo. Fired it the other way, and it comes off the boards and goes all the way back into Montreal's goal. Brown wanted a nice call, but he won't get one. Canadian starting out. Dufresne had to kick it to center ice. Now Skruglin. Skruglin finds very little room to move on it. Now Richie, he's coming in. Can't get a shot. The Sabres checking him. It was Holler taking it back. In with Ledyard. Ledyard over the bridge to the shot. The glove save by Wall. They will hold him. They're in overtime. They play 5-21.
That's Ledyard and Holler, the two defensemen, on a 3-on-2. And Holler moved it quicker than he probably should have because he was afraid of getting trapped. Ledger, who got the pass, let the shot go and then turned back off ice because he was afraid of getting caught. So a little bit of a safety thought in the minds of Holler and Ledger slowed up what could have been a dangerous 3-on-2.
Both teams using fresh legs. Rick Five hasn't played all that much tonight, but he was out on that last shift for the Sabres. And as Harry mentioned, Stéphane Lebeau had a turn along with Andrew Kaplan for Montreal.
Now, Dudley has played Snuggerud on the wing with McGillney and Turgeon and Rob Ray on the wing. He played a lot this year with Vanderchuk there, but they're afraid of using Vanderchuk at left wing versus Courtnell at right wing. The speed differential is too much, according to Rick Dudley.
Turgeon, Snuggerud, and McGillney for Buffalo. Holler and Ledyard. Canadian Carbonell couldn't win it. Sabres at the line. Ledyard, clean shot, knocked down in front of the net. Turgeon chasing it. Desjardins after him and holding it with a skate. The Sabres, Turgeon, trying to move it behind the net. It bounces out front. Desjardins covering up. Sabres really pressing the Canadians inside that line. Montreal gets it out, comes back in and bounces behind the net. Lafay, what a pass to McBean. Carbonell with Courtnell coming in. Courtnell is in. He scores. Courtnell, Canadian, wins the game.
Well, we go back to Buffalo.
for game number six, and the Montreal Canadiens are one win away from polishing off the Sabres.
What a great burst of speed by Rut Cardinal. Sweeping by the two Sabres, moving on Malarchuk, going through the pad, and the game is over. The Canadiens won it on Cardinal's overtime goal at 5:56. Montreal now takes the lead in the series. Headed back ground.
He has stopped 47 of 51 shots sent his way. Dances and Pavanka. Pavanka wins the draw. Comes back to Hatcher. Hatcher with a shot. It's blocked. Kristen tries to get the rebound. Cleared by Amonte, playing his first NHL game. To Stephen Wright. Popped off the boards, and the Rangers clear to the Capitals line. This is the backpedaling Hatcher. Hatcher sends it up the middle to Bobaka. Bobaka for Kristich, who has to race after it along the near side. Kristich sends it cross ice for Hatcher. To Bruce. Bruce, and over the line, Bobaka offside. John Druce, the Caps playoff hero a year ago.
At the Forum in Montreal, it is now over. 5:56 into the extra frame. Guy Carboneau with the pass to Russ Cardinal to send him away. He splits the defense and then beats Clint Malarchuk. The Canadiens win it by a score of 4-3. They lead the series 3-2 and can wrap it up Saturday night with a win at the Auditorium in Buffalo. Let's get you back to Washington.
Richter, hope for a rebound and have one standing by there so you can just put one home. And I think that's the whole game plan. The Rangers backing in with their D. You can get a good shot from just inside the blue line. 6-1. Caps lead in shots on goal here in the extra session. Johansson fires it in deep. Hardy off the wall. Gives to Patrick. Patrick sends it ahead, and it was behind Turcotte. Deep into the Capital zone. First back touching it was the Capitals left winger Dave Tippett, and again the icing call, which brings the faceoff back in the Rangers zone.
Now they come oh so important in overtime. You can win right off the draw. They'll line up someone in the deep slot looking to win the draw directly. If it doesn't go to the guy in the deep slot, it's going to go to Ally Afraidy, who has that cannon from the blue line, or one of the other D. They're always trying to set up a play, especially in overtime.
Ridley and Turcotte. Set for this faceoff from the draw. Puck sent off the back wall. Hardy picks it up for the Rangers. Works it around here for Broughton, who is bumped by Johansson. Turcotte muscles with Kelly Miller. Here's a drive by King, gloved by Beaupre, and he will hold on.
Had that been earlier in the game, you might have seen Beaupre drop the puck and wing it around the boards to one of his forwards. But in overtime, he's making sure that he holds on to it and gets the faceoff. He doesn't want the puck to drop. Maybe it's going to be bouncing and allow the Rangers to come in and pick up those loose pucks.
Ellie Johansson seen plenty of ice time. In fact, most of the Capitals defensemen, maybe save for Sabourin, have seen an extended period of ice time. Kevin Hatcher has. Not seen too much of Sabourin here in the second half of this hockey game. From the faceoff, sent to the point. Hardy winds up with a shot. Beaupre, the pad save with King storming in front of the Capitals goaltender. Here's Miller across the line. Drops it for Ridley. Miller turns away, bumped along the boards. Langway with a shot. Ridley cruising in front, and Richter holds on.
Langway seems to be open in overtime more than he was the whole game. I think it's his fourth shot he's had directed towards the net. He's hitting Richter right in that Ranger emblem in his sweater, trying to get some traffic in front, trying to look for a rebound.
Speaking of traffic in front, notice there how Chris King was storming the Capitals net. They want to get Beaupre off his game.
Well, Chris King came right across, gave Beaupre a shot after he made the great save. Hardy gets the puck at the roller, and he lets one go, and Chris King right in the top of the crease area, not letting Beaupre come out to cut off the angle, and he gives him a little shove and knocks him down.
Hunter and Nichols set for this faceoff. From the draw, Tippett sends it back to Langway. Cross ice for Hatcher. Hatcher looking down low for Hunter, broken up by Leach. Hops over the stick of Erickson. Hatcher dumps it back in. And this one makes its way off the glass up into the crowd. And the faceoff will come outside the Ranger line.
but almost to center ice.
Al Kokin standing by downstairs with an update. Al?
Okay, Jeff, the other overtime game has been decided. Montreal at home gets the OT winner. They beat Buffalo 4-3, lead that series by the score, by the margin of 3-2. It's Wes Cortinall who got the OT winner. Back up to you guys.
Cortinall's enjoying some playoff success, to be sure. Langway up to center. Let one go, and a stick save by Richter. Tippett tries to pick it up on the rebound. Sends it behind the net. Leach first there. Off the wall. Poked ahead by Gartner. For Nichols with Leach breaking in. 3-on-2. A drop pass for Mike Gartner, and he sends it wide. He and Tippett bump along the far board. Hatcher gets it to Cicerelli. Cicerelli all by himself crosses the line. Gartner chasing him. Cicerelli from the corner. Sends it cross ice for Hunter. Hunter buffed by Leach. Nichols works it around. Iafredi throws it behind the net for Cicerelli. Gets away from Gartner. Here's Cicerelli in the wraparound. He scores! Dino Cicerelli! Dino Cicerelli has given the Capitals the victory. He was due, and he pulls the trigger. The Caps lead the series 3-2.
Well, what a big goal, Jeff, and what some hard work down low. You called it. Dino Cicerelli working down low, and he's so smart. That's what set up the goal. He hung behind the goal, waiting for the puck to come around.
The Washington Capitals mobbing their goaltender, Dino Cicerelli, who comes up with a very big goal. He's done it before. He was overdue, and the Capitals will skate off the ice victorious. They go back to Washington for a big game Saturday night and a 3-2 series lead.
That's the real concerns expressed after the fourth game in Edmonton.
For the St. Louis Blues this evening, Rich Sutter, the game-winning goal as St. Louis prevails 3-2 in the best of seven series against Detroit. The Blues will meet Minnesota in game one of the Norris Division Championship. And of course, we don't know who will face the Los Angeles Kings. It's 4-4, bound for overtime. Let's go upstairs to Chris Cuthbert and Jim Poplinski.
Thank you, Ron. The men on the hot seat, Mike Vernon and Grant Fuhr. What an outstanding goaltending exhibition we have seen in this series. Jim, this continues to bring back memories of 1989. I know how special it is to play in a seventh game. Can you explain what it's like in overtime in the seventh game?
Well, it's important that you don't play to lose the game. You want to have patience. I know a lot of the time overtimes end very quickly, but you have to make sure you don't make mistakes and wait for your time. If that time comes early, great. If not, you have to have that patience. Tremendous amount of pressure, but where confidence comes in, a guy like Darren Fleury has had that confidence throughout his career, and you get an opportunity to test it at the best level in the world. It doesn't get any better than this.
Great set. You try to end it within 5 minutes. Darren Fleury scored 4:40 of overtime. Here's the ritual the Oilers go through before the start of each period, and it's a very intricate ritual where every player on the ice has their role at a specific time. These guys are just as superstitious as the coaches on the planes with those ties tonight.
The great thing about being superstitious is you always deny that you are. I know as a player, I used to put stuff on at certain times. You can find yourself driving to the arena a certain route.
Speaking of which, Doug Risebrough rode his bike to the rink tonight. And if they win this evening, I think that bike's going to get a real workout in the next round. But how prophetic John Muckler's comments about momentum swings he anticipated tonight. He said the winner would be the team that handled them best.
Well, there's no question in any hockey game, and particularly one that comes under full scrutiny, when the game is over, it's very easy to look at the different swings and momentum. The key is to pick those swings out as they're happening and turn them in your favor. Both of these teams have been successful in doing that over the last 10 years.
Mark Messier has bad memories of overtime in game six. He'll hope to atone here. And right from the faceoff, the puck goes over the glass and out of play. Graves, Jelena, and Semenov starting up front for the Oilers. And this was the big line for them in this hockey game. But the big captain has yet to have his say yet. And he may in the extra session.
Tom Messier just putting the finishing touches on the skates. John Huffer getting this overtime at the line that scored a big goal and has played a real key part in the Oilers' comeback tonight.
Becker Eichhoff countering with Gilmore, Fleury, and Ranheim. That's the line that clicked for the overtime goal in Game 6. Martin Jelinek has had 7 shots on goal in the game to lead everybody. There's a guy, though, that the Oilers will be wary of in overtime.
Well, Gilmore is like a snake in a lot of ways. He can jump into holes, he can fend off checks, and right when you think you have him, he finds an opening. He's a tremendous passer, doesn't have a great shot. He's very accurate, and also has outstanding hand-eye coordination in front of your net.
Charlie Huddy gets the return pass, lost control, kept in by Musil. There's Fleury with the loose puck, puts it at the goal! And Grant Fuhr kicked it out with traffic in front. Fleury chops at it again. Musil can't keep it in. Now clears it back, and the Flames make a change as Benton comes over the boards with Wilson. Huddy carries out to Semenov. Cross ice to Jelinek. Jelinek's check. Graves follows up and steers another shot on goal. This line had 13 shots for the Oilers in the first 3 periods. Kernan leaves it for McCowan. Up to Fenton. Nice pass there to Wilson, trailing. Otto also in on the play. There's Otto, and he just failed to deflect that. Remember, he was the hero in 89 against Vancouver. Otto. In by Jeff Smith. What a spot for Smith, playing his first game of the series. And the noose is loose at center. Here's Mark Messier. Wrist shot, and oh, what a stop! Mike Vernon with the glove hand. Remember 89 and Mike Vernon in overtime.
Well, for all those that got on Mike Vernon when he let in the first one tonight, I think he just made up for it. Look at Messier taking a look around, and he's so strong going wide. Puts the puck between Nafris' skate and stick, manages to regroup and get it back, and Vernon with a tremendous glove save. Look at this ice angle. Look at Vernon with his glove up and ready. Puck doesn't go straight into his glove. Vernon has to make the move. A great save and a great shot by Mark Messier.
Mike Vernon trying to even his playoff record against the Edmonton Oilers, which is 7-8 lifetime.
Well, when you think of the number of shots that we've seen against Vernon, 164 up to this point, 38 tonight on top of that, Vernon has only been beaten 20 times. These have been great opportunities.
Otto won the faceoff. Bukerboom tries to keep it in. Glenn Anderson lost control to Otto, and it's out at center. Bukerboom clears it right back into the Calgary zone. Al MacInnis around the board, cut off by Anderson. His shot did escape. And now out come the Flames. Roberts with Stern and Neuendijk. Stern at the tying goal. Clears it behind the net. Steve Smith is there. He leaves it in the corner for Anderson. Stern right there for Calgary. Beats the point. Back to Stern. There's the shot. Glove hand by Fuhr with Roberts on the doorstep. And Bukerboom and Roberts have words in a little more.
Well, you have to watch your temper. Gary Roberts took a real beating from Bukerboom before the whistle. And I think that's the only reason that Don Pohorski didn't give Roberts a single 2 minutes. Bukerboom being very clever, and after Roberts fell and no penalty was assessed, Roberts tried to even the score. Look at the skirmish in front. Roberts right on top of Fuhr, and Bukerboom pushing him out of the way right here. In any other game, Roberts has an additional 2 minutes. Bukerboom just praying that Pohorski assesses it, but to no avail.
I'm not sure if that would be scored a knockdown, a slip, or a bit of a dive. Roberts would like to get a penalty, of course, if I can, against the Oilers.
I'd call that one a dive.
We played 2 minutes of overtime in Game 7. McTavish against Gilmore. Neuendijk and Fleury also. Up front for Calgary. From the faceoff. Lamb sprawling, can't clear it. Musil. On the backhand, puts it in front, and Huddy clears it. Here's Fleury, shot with traffic in front, and went wide. A real pileup
left in front of Grant Fuhr. At center ice, McIver gave it to Fleury. Fleury knocked down. And McTavish starts away. Craig McTavish picking his way to the flame line. Tikkanen winds up the shot line. And all the way back into the Edmonton zone.
Well, although there's a good portion of pressure in overtime, the game becomes very simple. You get the puck at the net, you make sure you pick up your checks, you keep your mouth closed and you stick down after your hit.
Tikkanen rink wide, and it's called on the offside at the Calgary line.
Well, you see Ron Lowe, between Kevin Lowe's brother Ken and John Hunkler. Ron Lowe came down to the bench after spending most of the time scouting up in the press box during games and on off games. I would run into him on a regular basis in Calgary, where he would be doing a little bit of advanced work to give the coaching staff and the rest of the Edmonton Oilers an indication of what they might expect when they played either the Flames or the team visiting the Saddledome.
Flames extended this to a seventh game with a win in overtime. Big collision there between Suter and Muni. Here come the Oilers, and it's offside again. Remember a year ago, though, when the season ended for the Flames with an overtime loss in Los Angeles. They're playing for a trip back to the Great Western Forum. What a collision that was. Gary Suter on the one end of it with Craig Muni.
Sit down and strap yourself in. That one hurts whether you're on the ice or watching it on TV. Muni got up a little quicker than Suter. Suter, who is a very, very strong guy, going with some pretty good speed. Take a look at this again. Look at Gary Suter, and this is chest to chest. Both guys go down, and that is a perfect picture of what has taken place in this series. Gary Suter getting Muni's shoulder right in the chest, and the wind leaves you. It'll take a minute for Suter to regain his touch before he can come back into this overtime period.
Muni continues. Suter has assists in each of the last four games, and we'll watch for his return. Jelena against McCowan, and McCowan showed you his strength there. Ron Stern met by Graves. Out at center ice. Jelena again. Vernon leads it for Natrick. Up to Roberts with room. Gary Roberts, Stern catching up. Nieuwendyk on the play. McCowan backhands it in front. Back from the Oilers. Jelena. Left side for Semenov. Jelena belted by Roberts. Now Gary Roberts tries to pull away. Up to Nieuwendyk. Nieuwendyk moves in and Bukavu knocks into the ice. Cleared. Kept in by Natrick. There's a shot wide. Wilson against Graves. Kick free for Otto. Here's Terry Wilson moving in. Looking to center. Graves sprawls. Fenton's in front. Wilson jams. Fuhr is down. Puck still loose. Otto chops on it. And Grant Fuhr keeps it out. And a real melee in front of the net now as Steve Smith tries to do some house cleaning.
Well, if you want a good picture of the law of the jungle, just watch this overtime. The rules have changed dramatically from penalties that were called in the first period. Joel Otto is feeling the effects of getting flattened in front of the net. The Bukavu taking big Otto, and Terry Wilson reminiscent of an overtime goal. He scored against the Oilers, neglecting to go to Paul Fenton and trying to stuff it. Look at everybody trying to find the puck, and Otto with another whack at it. Fenton augers in, and Smith picks him up.
Watch Joel Otto's frustration.
Otto is simply worn out, and he gets pushed down here by Bukavu. A feather could knock him over after that exchange.
Another big faceoff in the Oilers zone. McInnes has a chance. Here's the shot. It goes high. And Messier has it for Edmonton. Up to Charlie Huddy. Oilers break out. Anderson. McTavish on the other wing. Centered in front. Charlie Huddy. Grabbed by Gilmore. Fleury starts back. Here's Theron Fleury. And his shot goes wide. Play whistled down. And Charlie Huddy down at the other end is hurt after being thrown to the board by Doug Gilmore.
Huddy and Gilmore went into the boards. As you see, trainer Ken Lowell running out to tend to Huddy. The two of them went into the boards and they were spinning around when Gilmore pushed him. Huddy went in head first.
The Oilers have already lost Kevin Lowe out after the sixth game. Some anxious gentlemen in the Oilers box, and John Buckler and the Oilers bench exploded when Gilmore tossed Huddy into the boards. They thought Don Gawarski should have called a penalty. Here's what happened.
Look at, they're kind of spinning around. Gilmore grabs him, as you can see. It doesn't hit him that hard, but Huddy in an awkward position in that dangerous distance from the boards. If you're a little closer, you can get your hands up against the glass. If you're a little further away, you fall on the ice and your hands can protect you hitting the ice. Charlie Huddy, after wrestling with Gilmore, and he gets a talking to by Koharski.
The Edmonton Oilers are 12-8 in Stanley Cup overtime. Calgary Flames 11-12 again. Charlie Huddy still trying to shake the effects off of that hit. The Flames of a 3-2 edge in head-to-head overtime.
Well, Huddy looking at his helmet. The type of helmet that he wears offers less protection than a couple others would.
Flames control another faceoff. Gilmore centers it. Here's a chance for Ranheim. It's blocked. Ranheim again! Can't get the shot away. Puck cleared to the corner. Anderson takes over. Flames have had the best chances so far. Anderson pass, Fleury out to center. Checked by Ranheim. Now Fleury's back with Gilmore. Here's Darren Fleury, wrist shot. Rebound! And good knock again as the net is knocked ajar.
Well, Mark Messier, you can detect the hobble. I didn't see what happened, but he went down right at the top of the circle. He was very slow getting up. He really gritted his teeth. He really grit his teeth and had to fight to get back into the play to put a hook on Darren Fleury. Messier catching his breath, and let's see if we can tell what took place. He was in pretty good shape here. He's looking for the puck, and he gets fouled. Fleury fell on the back of his legs, and as Messier got up, watch how slowly he gets up here. You see the pole and his stick, and the hobble. Mark Messier then takes a push from Craig McTavish to make matters worse. And it's all he can do to get back in the play.
That looks like the same knee he injured at the start of the year against the St. Louis Blues and re-injured right here at the Saddle Dome on December 22nd in a collision with Doug Gilmore. Will we see Messier again? I'm sure we will, but boy, that knee problem has plagued him all season long. This overtime has gone longer than the one in game six. We're 4:57 in. Fleury ended the last game in 4 minutes and 40 seconds of sudden death. Lamb and Gilmore to the right of Fuhr. What a great line by Grant Fuhr when asked about the pressure of the seventh game. He said, pressure was back in September when he had to deal with the accounts of his drug problem and the suspension. McKinnis. The side of the net, Neuendijk tied up by Munich. Look at that stick right behind him. He's not going anywhere like that. And Gilmore lassoed by the rodeo cowboy, Mark Lamb.
Well, there was a number of counts being issued. Gilmore had Lamb pinned in front of the net for a takedown. Neuendijk was in the corner trying to fight off one of his own.
Here's another look at Muni and Neuendijk, and he's not letting Neuendijk get that stick loose.
Now this is close checking, and a good play by Muni, and then Jeff Smith comes in and pins Stern. You don't want to be in a hurry to move away from a guy, particularly a guy like Neuendijk. If you take him against the boards and hold him there, he's a lot less dangerous than if you allow him to get back in the play before you know exactly where the puck is.
You saw Charlie Huddy just tell the coaches he's okay. Norm McIver looking in. He's never been in this situation before. Gary Suter's back on the ice, so that's good news for the Flames. Suter back after taking that hit from Munich. Mark Lamb at center. Pinched out by McCallum. Suter goes back, overshakes it, peeking and watching him. And play whistle down. Paul Baxter mentioned to me earlier in this series, it's like Hudson Bay rules out there, and that's what's at stake right now. Hey, Baxi.
Paul Baxter has Bishop's got a good grasp on what Hudson Bay rules are. You see him waving a little bit earlier just before we went to Mark Messier. Messier just testing out the knee and then back to the bench. But Paul Baxter was waving up to the left of the location that we're at, getting some instructions from Guy Charron and then motioning to him with hand signals. Guy Charron up in the booth a couple of feet to our left, and he can relay instructions to the coaching staff as most teams do. The coaching staff with different situations that he might notice during the period.
Flames control another faceoff. They've been strong in that department. Gary Roberts at center. Drifts the shot in. Kerry Wilson gives chase. And Wilson has it in the corner. Watched by Graves and hauled down by the Oilers center. Jelinek can't chop it out. Now Graves up with it again and makes no mistake.
Well, both teams are treading on a potential penalty call. The game keeps going like this. Eventually, Don Kuharski will assess the penalty to one side or the other because guys will start to take too many liberties.
Graves and Wilson got their sticks high as Calgary's called for icing. And Don Kuharski's not shy about calling penalties in overtime.
You see the Vaseline on the face of Jim Kite. Vaseline is a handy thing for sticks and the odd scrap. If you get hit with a stick or a punch, you're a little less likely to get cut. And Messier once again just testing his leg, seeing how it feels, and he is on his way to the faceoff. As soon as the action starts, he'll get a lot better indication of how that is. And John Muckler obviously concerned with right now, but what about if the Oilers win? And you look at your star player with the potentially having an injury that would take him out of the next series.
Muckler's team was 8-17-2 without their captain in the lineup this year, but he's out there now against Joel Otto. Oilers win the draw, shot right on. Gilmore off the boards and out to center. This is the big line for the Oilers. And John Muckler wanted to see production out of Simpson and Messier tonight. He said they have to cash in on their chances. They've had 20 in the series. Messier with two goals, Simpson with two goals. Anderson has scored tonight. And Messier's going back to the bench. McKinnis out at center. Gilmore can't handle it. Greg Beauty to Steve Smith. Hits the red line, flips it in. More changes for the Oilers. McTavish runs McKinnis into the glass. Beauty pinches up. And now Tikkanen circles at center. 3 points in the game. A couple of goals for Esa Tikkanen. Six in the series. Shoot scores! Esa Tikkanen has won it for the Oilers. Vernon and the Calgary Flames. Satikinen. And there's Joe Nieuwendyk, who just said congratulations to his cousin Jeff Kukubu.
Well, Joe Nieuwendyk was a tower of strength for the Calgary Flames. Nieuwendyk and Roberts in particular led this team back to give them an opportunity for a seventh game. You see Adam Graves going off. He's a guy that didn't put a whole pile of points on the board in this series, but that kid line was absolutely outstanding.
John Muckler told me before the game, Essentikinen's gone dry. He's got to find his scoring touch again. Did he ever tonight? But not before the Flames built a quick lead, 3-0 in the first period. The key goal might have been Tikkanen's first for the Oilers. That was the big goal by Tikkanen, 3-1 after one. Then in the second period, the Oilers came back to tie it 3-3. And we went to the third period. Semenov gave the Oilers a lead. Stern came right back to tie it. And Essentikinen, a hat-trick goal in overtime, unassisted. Here's another look at the series winner by number 10 of the Oilers.
Well, watch Tikkanen, and he gets the shot away. An unbelievable shot and a deflection to beat Vernon.
The final score, Edmonton 5, Calgary 4.
The Oilers win. Here are the Molson three stars tonight. Not much doubt about number one with a hat-trick, including the game winner in overtime, Essentikinen. The second star, Theron Fleury of the Calgary Flames, who had a three-point night. And star number three from the Edmonton Oilers, Craig McTavish. The Oilers win in OT, and here's one of the stars. And Essent, tell me about this shot.
Well, first of all, I was thinking about it fast as Peter Clément coming wide open there, and then I changed my mind and tried to shoot the net, and it was going goal.
Let's go right back to the start of the game. Tell me about it as you saw it.
Well, we was in a 2-0 down, and two power play goals there, and then it goes 3-0 up, and we take a timeout there and say, let's go, guys, settle down and try to do a couple goals there right in the back in the game. So we got a one goal there before the period ends, and was like team start to think about it that time right now, and we have a chance to win the game.
You seem to be one of the people conducting that timeout. We saw pictures of you at the bench, and you were really saying a lot. What exactly were you saying?
Well, exactly what I said before. We relax and try to do our stuff, what we've been practicing, and exactly what we did in, after the two periods, 40 minutes, and we win the game.
On that first goal late in the first period, did the shot dip at all, or was it through McInnes's legs? Do you recall?
No, I think that was going straight through for him, and I think Mike never see that one, and was lucky goal, but we take those and go in that way in LA.
Tell me about some of the other players on your team who you think had big games tonight.
Well, I think everybody was big games. Cranfield playing it again in big for us, and I think every whole team played together in an excellent hockey game, and there's no doubt that we have an excellent series, and Calgary play excellent, was tough series, and too bad one team has to lost.
Absolutely. And look ahead to Los Angeles, as I know that's the last thing in your mind, but what about the Kings Thursday?
Well, I think that's coming hard series, too. You know, you're looking at a great one, Wayne Gretzky's there, and we think about it only one game in a time, and we go in that way and try to win the first one and see what's happened.
You were such a big part of last year's seven-game win in the first round, you and Jari. Can't say enough about the Finns and their contribution to this championship cause in Edmonton. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Essentikinen, number one star for the Edmonton Oilers. Is he ever a Big Ten? 5-4, Edmonton in overtime. They defeat Calgary to advance to the Spite Division Finals. Stay tuned for more on Molson Hockey Net in Canada and the Stanley Cup playoffs on CBC. Stanley Cup champions are alive. 5-4, they win in overtime. We will have the thoughts of Don Cherry to wrap things up here at the Olympic Saddle Dome in Calgary when we continue on Molson Hockey Net in Canada on CBC. On.
Well, I'll tell you, I said at the start of the game, these are two teams to be proud of, and if you're going to tell me you've seen a better series than this, even my Montreal Bruins was great. It was never any better than this. I feel so sorry for Mikey Vernon. He played so well. It wasn't a bad goal. He was screened a little, but should have been one of the stars. 40 shots, played great. And Fuhr, but with what I said before, there's something about Grant Fuhr when you go into overtime, and I'll tell you, two gutsy clubs, I'll tell you.
How's Messier?
Messier, he was shaking his head. I was watching him on the bench. He was shaking him. He has to come back for them to do anything against L.A. But I've said it before, and I've said it again many times, Messier with one leg is as good as guys with two. Good luck to both teams. They were great.
We'll see the Oilers again Thursday night at Los Angeles, and tomorrow night it's Montreal at Boston, so plenty to look forward to on Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC. Good night.
Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC was brought to you by Molson Canadian. What beer's all about? By Esso Associates and Imperial Oil. You're on your way with Esso. And by Pepsi. It's got what it takes.
This has been a CBC Sports presentation in association with Molstar Communications.
CBC Television, official broadcast.
For the fourth period in Boston tonight, the Canadians trying to even the series in the Adams Division final. Meanwhile, in the Patrick Division, that game is tied 6-6. They have just started overtime. Let's join Rick Peckham and Jerry Cheever.
We welcome the Hockey Night in Canada audience to the Civic Arena here in Pittsburgh. Rick Peckham and Jerry Cheever's with you. We've played a minute, 16 seconds of overtime, tied up at 6. And the Capitals control the faceoff after the Penguins had a couple of good scoring chances in the early going here of overtime. They want to keep the pressure going. Stevens pass taken away by Johansson. Leads it ahead for Cicerelli. Cicerelli sends it off the glass around to Dave Tippett. Stevens backhands it to Mullen. Francis gives it now to Stevens. Cuts in on Johansson. Stevens backhands it on goal to save by the Ute. Rebound left there for the taking. Hunter finally gets a stick on it. Francis controls it, trying to neat between the legs away from the net. Centering attempt, but the Caps spoil that. Cicerelli. Big drive from center. It's off the skate of Roberts, controlled by Pietrangelo. Capitals go for a change. The pass skips off Stevens' stick. Jágr will chase down the puck along with Ally Afraidy, who got there first, and it's icing against Pittsburgh.
Watching Liut make that big save at the start of overtime, you know, I think of a great move that David Poile made in getting Mike Liut when Don Beaupre was questionable at the start of this season. It's nice to have a veteran goaltender like Mike Liut put into this position. It'll be his game to win or lose. Jágr, who scored a winning goal in Series 1 against the New Jersey Devils for the Penguins, should see plenty of ice time as he has that breakaway ability. But Liut, good to have a guy like him. If you have to replace your number one goalie, it's a pretty big edge when you do it with a guy like Liut.
Boy, did he come up with a great stop on Jágr in the third period as Jágr danced around Ally Afraidy in alone on the Capitals goaltender. Murphy gets to that puck, checked by Drews. Murphy moves it along to Troy Loney. Liut out to play that bouncing puck. Controls it for Langway. Long pass ahead for Leach.
We will keep you updated on the overtime action in Pittsburgh, where those two teams are tied at 6. Coming up next from Boston, it's the first overtime period between the Canadians and the Bruins. Boston leads the series, and the Canadians try to earn a split. Our Stanley Cup playoff coverage continues in a moment.
John Garrett and Nick Urban at the Boston Garden, and there it is. A tie game after three periods. The goal by Richie at 11:30. Set up overtime, and we're about to go in period four. Roy and Mould have been super in this game. And overtime in the Boston Garden in game two of the Adams final is underway. Bob Sweeney. Bob Sweeney nearly stole it. Here's Don. Bumped by Corson. Côté moves in from the blue line, tipped it into the corner. Strulin digging it out. Here is Strulin trying to center it. He's tied up. Gets a pass away. Right in front of the net. They score! Richey gets the overtime goal in 27 seconds. And the Canadians win 4-3. And the series is tied.
You know, Bob, it's interesting. The Boston Bruins did not lose a game in overtime this season. They played 17 times in overtime and didn't lose. Now here they are in their first overtime game in the playoffs this year, and they lose it in 27 seconds, John.
I don't like the fact that they started a defensive line in their own building. Sure, the Canadians start their best offensive line, Richey and Strudlin, and Richey catches in right there. But the Bruins started a defensive line. They're in a defensive mode right away, and they got burned.
So So the Canadians continue to celebrate, and a big night for Stéphane Richer. You mentioned John off the top of the show. He had to do something, and he did with the tying and winning goals here in Boston.
Richer scored 11:30 of the third period to send the game into overtime. And at 27 seconds, he scored the winner. And the Canadians even the series at a game each.
Saving some stories we're following tonight, the U.S.